The Art of Learning is a book about the pursuit of excellence. It's a book about my life, my careers in chess and the martial arts. But more than anything, it's about a love for the process. Writing this book was very emotional, because I was going back into the skin of myself as a 6, 7, 8-year-old boy, seeing chess for the first time. I wrote about that moment that I saw chess in Washington Square Park, that very first time. I remember the shape of the pieces. I remember the experience of chess as this jungle that pulled me in. And I remember this feeling, this bizarre feeling of discovering a lost memory, as if I'd seen chess before. I remember that first game, and then the process of learning chess as a very little boy, my initial surge of growth, my first national championship that I lost, and then the year of trying to overcome the disappointment of that first big loss into ultimately winning my first national championship the next year. Very emotional, and writing about it, putting myself, you know, back into those days was very powerful for me. I've always hated the word prodigy. I think it's dehumanizing. As a kid, I was called a prodigy. It's something I had to deal with. And I think that when you're labeled genius, prodigy, wunderkind, I think that it denies the human struggle against adversity, which is at the center of my relationship to success. I think that anybody can become tremendously successful at what they do, as long as they approach the learning process in a way that isn't self-paralyzing. And it's my hope that my book helps pave the way for them to do that. Beginner's mind is approaching things with that wonderful, fresh, open spirit of a child. Children look at something and they just want to learn it. They soak in the information. They don't worry about looking bad for a minute or for two, or for 10, or for a few days or for weeks. They just want to learn. They have this fresh, vibrant spirit. And it's an incredibly easy thing to have a beginner's mind when we're a beginner, when we're learning something, and we have that initial growth surge in the beginning of learning any pursuit where we have so much to learn because we don't know anything. And so we learn and we learn and we learn, and then we start to be told that we're good, we start to feel proficient, and then we start to have our ego attached. And we start to think that we have some answers, and that's when things get dangerous. We see a lot of teachers who try to fit all their students into a cookie cutter mold. And that's a very big problem, because you can have, for example, a young chess player who's an incredibly gifted attacking player, whose teacher is a very conservative positional player. And the teacher knows how to create someone in his own image. And so he tries to fit that student into the mold, which was good for himself, but it was bad for the student. And the student would do much better to have a teacher who was open to bringing out that student's natural shine, their natural strengths. So it's a very tough balance. We have to be very true to our strengths, be aware of our natural talents, the flavor of our game, because I think at the highest level, an artist to express himself or herself needs to be as unobstructed as possible in the way they express themselves through their art. And on the other hand, we have to be willing to let go of our strengths and work on our weaknesses. Searching for Bobby Fischer really changed my life. In some ways, it threw a rock into the gear of my professional life and my love for chess, because I was a kid who was so passionate about an art, about a discipline that was very internal, very cerebral. And chess for me was a vehicle for internal growth, primarily. And I was a good competitor, but I loved studying chess. And I loved expressing myself through chess. And then when the movie came out, suddenly there was this spotlight on me that I wasn't necessarily ready for. There were fans, there were girls screaming and yelling when I came to tournaments, asking me to sign their legs, sign their stomachs. Well, that was really great for a 17-year-old boy, 16-year-old boy. It was difficult for an artist, for a young kid who wasn't necessarily capable of maintaining perspective on all these issues. And I think the effect that it had more than any was that slowly it started to pull me from having this internal relationship to chess to slowly looking at it from the outside. I remember this alienating moment of sitting in a chess tournament, watching myself think from across the room. And that was so different from being so deeply into chess that nothing could tear me away.
What about the film? I mean, when the film came out, how did it change your chess life?
The film had a very powerful effect on my life. It came out. He's cracking me up. He, you know, that's what was just our laughing.
I know the answers. Okay. And the movie imposed like a different quality to our lives.
Well, the movie came out when I was 15, 16 years old, and my career was flying. I was he's just laughing. I don't know if this is going to be a problem then.
Okay.
Come on, you can do it.
You can't sit over here.
Yeah, so I can't.
No, but you can't sit over there, because then she can't hear your question, and then I'm looking into space, and I'm answering the window. You have to be like an empathetic human being talking
empathetic
to me.
Empathetic human being. Well, maybe some of this will work. I mean, maybe
no, I don't think this isn't going to work that good, Pop.
But, I mean, listen, you know, it doesn't have to be so grave. So should we try this again?
Can I talk to the side of his face? I can't answer. I mean, I'm sitting here next to you, and you're shaking, trying to suppress laughter. Is it not working out?
No, I didn't anticipate this.
When people ask me why I stopped playing chess, and that's probably the question that I hear the most, I tend to say that I lost the love. And I guess if I were to be a little bit more true, I would say that I became separated from my love. I became alienated from chess somewhat. And I think, to be honest with you, the external pressures of the film coming out, the spotlight, the need that I felt to win all the time, as opposed to the freedom to explore the art more and more deeply, you know, I think that started to move me away from the game. And also, chess for me was so intimate. It was something that I loved so deeply that when I started to become alienated from it, I couldn't do it in an impure way. It was a wonderful time in my life when I started Tai Chi, because I needed so badly to get away from the spotlight, get away from the pressures of my chess career. And I was a beginner. I was just another guy in the room. I didn't tell anyone about the film or about being a chess champion. That was what I wanted to get away from. And I learned. And it was such an exciting time, because I was so wide open to every last bit of information. And I had no ego about being wrong. I'd be learning the Tai Chi form, and if there was something a little off, my teacher would tell me. And I didn't need to prove to him that I was right in any way. I wanted to be molded into this new discipline. In the first year and a half, 2 years of my study of Tai Chi, I was having this interesting experience of translating my ideas from chess over into the martial arts. And sometimes it began to feel as though I wasn't doing Tai Chi, but I was playing chess in the martial arts, and vice versa, because I was still playing chess somewhat. And I remember one time I was giving a simultaneous chess exhibition in Memphis, and I realized about halfway through, about 2 hours into the exhibition, that I wasn't playing chess. I wasn't thinking in chess language with chess notation. I was feeling flow, filling space left behind like I would in the martial arts. And my approach to both arts became barrierless. They became the same. When I was doing Tai Chi, I was playing chess. When I was playing chess, I was doing Tai Chi. And I became fascinated with the idea of the interconnectedness of the learning process. And I started to investigate the principles of learning, which, to my mind, started to transcend specific disciplines and related much more to learning itself. And I was competing in the super heavyweight championship of a very big big tournament. And my opponent was a 230-pound bruiser, big, strong guy, powerful, fast. Also kind of had a mean streak to him. And I was winning the match. We were in the very, about 45, 50 seconds to go. And in the middle of a martial flurry, my hand broke. He popped his shoulder into my hand, and I remember feeling it shatter, and this crazy sense of heat flew down. But the second the hand broke, time slowed down. It was an amazing, probably the most amazing perceptual experience of my life, because he was coming at me like a blitz. But in the video, his hands looked like bullets. But in my mind, he was coming at me like a cloud, super soft, like this. Slow, slow, slow. And I was able to, I knew my hand was broken. And I was seeing him coming in slow motion. And I was able to win the match very easily with one hand. And that moment became something that was pivotal for me in my martial arts life, because I had seen what the human mind is capable of perceiving time so differently. And I talk about in my book the idea of slowing down time. I started to create ways of changing your perceptual patterns at will without breaking a limb or without having something catastrophic happen. Learning how to change your perception. So in my life, these moments, these brutally painful losses, these physical injuries, these types of the negative moments have been the ones which have kind of spurred my learning process most intensely.